The birth of the Spirit. The Lord God commanded Adam in Genesis 2, 16 through 17, of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. God gave man this one rule to obey. Genesis 3 and 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And because man was unwilling to obey this one rule of God, he was cursed to eventually die, as God had said. The ground was also cursed because of their disobeying the Lord. Genesis 3:17. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree, of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake, in sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Since the time of Adam and Eve, there passed many generations before Moses, the writer of Genesis, was born. God communicated with man by a matter of conscience and awareness of God, because until the call of Moses, there was no lawgiver to write the law of God and deliver it unto the people. God chose men of faith to reveal his plan to redeem lost humanity and provide himself a savior to mankind. Allow me to give you a simplified explanation of what God would do to save lost humanity. Every man born of the seed of Adam and his descendants were under the curse of death. Jesus Christ was not born as other men, but rather was born of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost conceived in Mary, a virgin young woman, that she might give birth to our Lord Jesus. The mission of Jesus was to someday shed his pure, sinless blood as an atonement for our sin and purchase our salvation. Jesus Christ never sinned as other men did. By repenting of our sins and by our confession of faith and taking on his name in baptism and receiving the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, we become children of God. St. John 1 and 12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Many people interpret to receive him as nothing more than a decision or verbal statement of faith in him, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Others of us agree that decision is indeed required for our salvation, but is only the first step of salvation. We must consider all of Christ's teachings and instructions as necessary, and to comply with them to fulfill our part in the equation. Jesus taught in John 14:23, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Spiritual rebirth is biblical. The born-again experience is more than a decision. It is a change that only the power of God can work in us. Jesus told his disciples before his trial and crucifixion in St. John 14, 16 through 18 and verse 26, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. St. John 14:26 says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. In verse 26, Jesus identifies the Comforter as the Holy Ghost, that the Father would send it in his name, that is to say, in Jesus' name. Jesus told Nicodemus in St. John 3, verses 5 through 6, I say unto thee, except a man be born again of water and of spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. In the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8, we are told, ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Acts chapter 1 and 2 relate to us the first initial outpouring of the gift of the Holy Ghost. Those who witnessed this miracle asked Peter in Acts 2, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said unto them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call." If receiving the Holy Ghost is not required for our salvation, why would Jesus have spent so much time instructing about it in John chapter 14? To those who would say it is no longer required, I will ask, when did God change it? The Bible plainly says the promise is unto you and your children and to all that are far off. That must surely include all of us. Repentance is required that our sins may be blotted out. Acts 3 verse 19 states, "Repent you therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." The refreshing that comes from the presence of the Lord is the gift of the Holy Ghost, the Comforter that Jesus spoke of in St. John chapters 14 and 15. The Bible teaches that we must be baptized in Jesus' name, Acts 4 and 12. "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved." We confess that name when we take it on in baptism, as they did in Acts chapter 10 verse 48. They were to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Who is the Lord? Jesus is Lord. The Holy Ghost gives us power to do great things for the kingdom of God. Acts chapter 4 verses 30 and 31. "By stretching forth thine hand to heal, that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. And when they prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness." God hears our sincere prayers for salvation. Acts 10, 44 through 48 says, "While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, Can any man forbid water, that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord." They spoke with tongues as they did back in Acts chapter 2. The scriptures teach much about the miracle of salvation. The Holy Bible is our roadmap. Praise the Lord.